new here, my name is John Logan. I'm one of the ministers here. I'm glad that you've made the time to come out and visit with us. But more importantly, I want to go through announcements and some things that you want to keep on y'all's radar, especially in the month of November. First thing that is coming up is that we have our men's fellowship on the 14th of November. I'm following up that week on the 16th is our brotherhood breakfast. Our breakfast here is going to be actually in New Orleans as well. So keep that on your radar. As well, keep on your radar on November 21st. It is the Golden Angels, our women's choir that's going to be in town. And as well, following week is YEC, our Youth Evangelism Conference. So all my youth, if you haven't signed up yet, we want to make sure y'all come out as soon as possible. But also we want to sign up as soon as possible to where we're not meeting a deadline. Now, I also want to go into looking at Luke chapter 12, verses 24. I see a lot of anxiety in the world, a lot of people panicking and freaking out, especially from a lot of Christians. If you're curious on how to handle that anxiety, how to handle those overwhelming feelings, I want you to remember this as well. It says in verses 24 of chapter 12, consider the ravens. They don't sow or reap. They don't have a storeroom or a barn, and yet God feeds them. And aren't you worth more than those birds? God provides for the birds, the ravens, and yet you're worth more to God than those things. If you're feeling anxious and overwhelmed with what's going on, God's provision is more, and He will provide for His people. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Bow your heads and close your eyes. Lord, as we go into a time of worship to where we glorify You, and as we go and as Brother Tracey leads us in a time of learning, let it be Your words and not his. And Lord, let us put aside all distractions so that we can be diligent in praising and learning about You. Lord, show Yourself to us today in a mighty way that is not like any other, to where it changes our lives from wickedness into righteousness, and we go more and more into His image. Lord, we love You. We do this in Your Son's mighty name. Amen. Y'all can stand up and greet someone that you haven't seen yet. And if someone new, make sure you give them a big hug and a warm welcome.
you're seated. Let's continue singing, Bless His Holy Name.
Get together. Our most gracious Heavenly Father, we are thankful to be back in your house today. Serve you in spirit and in truth, Lord. Lord, we do pray for this nation as it turmoil is in. First, before we go to the polls to vote, Lord, let us first come to you and ask your will, what should be done first, and then go. Heavenly Father, we do pray for the sick of this community. We pray for the sin sick, the ones that away from you, Lord, that they may come into your fold. Thank you for the blessing that you are going to let the one that speaks bring a message to us this day. Prepare our hearts so we may receive the great blessing you have in store for us. We ask you to take these tithes and offerings to your benefits and your glory. We ask in thy name, Jesus. Amen.
Amen.
It is good that we as Christians can get together and get excited about going to heaven one of these days. I know many of you are looking forward to that. You wish that day would come sooner and sooner. You wish it was today. You wish that the Lord would just go ahead and take you home. And I've often thought about, you know, it would be nice that as soon as the Lord saved us, that he'd take us right on to glory, right then and right there. But as Christians, he has left us here for a purpose. As Christians, he's put us in this nation for a purpose as well. And so as we get into this topic of Nehemiah and what he was doing, I want you to think about how relational it is and how comparable it is to our nation today and what they were going through in that time when Nehemiah rebuilt the walls of the city of Jerusalem. So we're talking about, we want to see Jesus. We're looking at different pictures of Jesus Christ in the Old Testament. And Nehemiah is one of those pictures. Nehemiah was much, much more than just a wall builder. He was in the ministry of restoration. And so if you know anything about home construction and remodeling, demolition is the fun part. Tearing stuff down, that's the easy part. Just about anybody can do that. But to actually put something back together and bring it back to its pristine original condition, it takes special talent. It takes time and patience for that. So as I begin thinking about that, I think about how many years it took to build this nation up to what it is and how right now it is being torn down day in and day out, mainly from those within who seek its destruction. And so as I began thinking about that, I thought about the time that Marcy and I moved into the house that we're in right now. It was December of 2022, one of the coldest weeks that I've experienced since I've been here. It actually froze down here. I mean, there was icicles and stuff. It was a very, very cold week, and that's one of the reasons I'll never forget it. The week that we moved into this house, it was below freezing. And so we were there in December of 22, and in February of 23, the house right next to us caught on fire one night. I'll never forget that evening. It was right before Valentine's Day. We were sitting in the living room, still had things that we were unpacking, remodeling, and so forth, and I just smelled something that didn't smell quite right, and I opened up the door, and there was just this cloud of smoke drifting across my front lawn, and I just knew it was our house that was on fire. But as I looked, the flames were coming out of the roof of the house next to us. And so I began thinking about that. You know, in a matter of just a few hours, my hat's off to the volunteer, to the fire departments around here, both volunteer and the paid workers. They did a phenomenal job responding to that and keeping the fire under control. But as I began thinking about that, within a matter of hours, something that took someone possibly months to build was destroyed in an instant almost. And then a few months later, they brought in a crew. They had a backhoe, a track hoe, a bulldozer. The ground was shaking because they were chipping up the foundation. And in a matter of just a couple of days, everything from that house was scooped up, placed in a dump truck, hauled off, and there was nothing but dirt left. And so it only takes a very, very short time to actually tear something down and to destroy it. But it takes quite a bit of time to rebuild something to its original shape and its original form. So as we think about what was going on in the days of Nehemiah, it was around 587 B.C., I believe, was the time. Zedekiah was king of Israel, and a man by the name of Nebuchadnezzar came in and completely wiped out the city of Jerusalem. 587 B.C., Zedekiah was king. You can look that up in 2 Kings chapter 25, 2 Chronicles chapter 36. So Zedekiah was an evil king. He did what was wrong in the sight of the Lord, and he rebelled against Nebuchadnezzar. And Nebuchadnezzar, in retaliation to that, came in. He built up walls, besieged walls against the city of Jerusalem. He tore down the temple, destroyed it, and probably in just a matter of a few days, completely wiped out what it took many, many years to build in the city of Jerusalem. So we fast forward to 446 B.C., the inhabitants of Jerusalem were taken away to Babylon. They were in captivity with Nehemiah. The king that Nehemiah was under in the area of Babylon was Artaxerxes. So in 446 B.C., the Lord impressed upon Nehemiah's heart to go back and rebuild the walls of Jerusalem. Ezra had already went back and established the temple and began worship of Jehovah in the city of Jerusalem. So the worship was setting a priority to the restoration of the city. And in the original Hebrew Bible, the book of Ezra and Nehemiah were of one book, but since they had two different purposes, two different characters in the canon of scripture that you have. They are two separate books. So here's the thing about Nehemiah. Nehemiah loved the Lord, number one, first and foremost. Number two, Nehemiah loved his country as well. And number three, Nehemiah was a statesman. He wanted to do whatever it took to see his country, his city, his hometown restored back to its full purpose and glory. So Nehemiah had one goal and one mission in mind: make Jerusalem great again. He had one purpose. The Lord impressed upon his heart and burned his heart in such a way to where he fasted, he wept, and the first thing Nehemiah did before he ever lifted a stone or recruited anybody to be on his team was he prayed to the Lord, "Lord, bless this work and go with me as we begin this restoration process." So are we in the ministry of restoration? We as Christians, we are here for a reason. Each and every day we experience people that this world and this culture has broken and torn down. And just like Nehemiah and Jerusalem had their enemies. Israel has had their fair share of enemies throughout the centuries. Hezbollah that they are facing right now, this is not the only enemy that Israel has ever had. The Babylonians, the Egyptians, they had many, many different enemies throughout their history. And let me just say this. You have an enemy as well. His name is Satan. And he wants to do everything he can to tear you down, to destroy you, and turn you away from the Lord, and help you to not fulfill your purpose here on this earth. Jesus said the enemy comes not but to kill, steal, and destroy. But Jesus said that he came so that we might have life everlasting and life more abundantly. So maybe you're in a position right now to where your life is broken down. Life has handed you something that's tough and hard to deal with. You don't feel like you're in a position to fulfill your purpose with the Lord. What you need in your life is some restoration. Or maybe you've seen someone whose their life has been broken down. Their family is in shambles, and they need somebody to come along with them and help them to restore what the Lord wants to do in their life. Let's all stand and turn to the book of Nehemiah. I want to show you how this story started off. And point number one is that Nehemiah's genuine concern for his city was expressed by action and tears. Nehemiah chapter 1. Let's just start in verse 1. The words of Nehemiah, the son of Hakaliah, it came to pass in the month of Cheslev, in the 20th year as I was in Shushan, the citadel, that Hananiah, one of my brethren, came with men from Judah and asked them concerning the Jews who had escaped, who had survived the captivity. And concerning Jerusalem, that they said to me, "The survivors who are left from the captivity in this province are there in great distress and reproach." Do you know anybody who's in great distress right now? Perhaps the Lord is calling you to help them in the restoration process in their life. But here's what was going on in Jerusalem. The wall of Jerusalem is also broken down, and its gates are burned with fire. So what he's saying is that our city is vulnerable to the enemy right now. It has no protection. It has no defenses. What are we going to do? So here was the first step in Nehemiah's restoration process. So it was that when I heard these words, that I sat down and wept and mourned for many days. I was fasting and praying before the God of heaven. And we're going to come back to this after a while because I want to read some of this prayer. This is a very, very significant prayer, and it's a great prayer for you to model in your own prayers for our nation, for our country right now. But let me ask you this question. When is the last time that you were burdened for your country to the extent of you fasted and prayed and wept over it? I know many of you are mad about what's going on in our country right now, but getting mad about it doesn't do anything. If you'll come back tonight, we're going to look at Hebrews chapter 4, and it says, "Let us therefore come boldly before the throne of grace, so that we might find mercy and grace to help in our time of need." And so that's my petition to you this morning. And when we get into the invitation in just a little while, it's going to be with a very, very specific purpose, and that's to pray for our nation and to pray for our election that's coming up 2 days from now. Heavenly Father, we come before you this morning. Thank you so much for this day. God, our country is in distress right now. There's just no other way to put it. Our walls are broken down. Our defenses are weak. We have enemies on the inside, Lord God, that want to tear us up and tear us down and destroy us. But Lord, our motto is that we are one nation under God. And Lord, whatever it takes for us as Christians to help to restore our lives, our family, our community, our nation that we live in, Lord God, I pray that you would burden our hearts in such a way that we would see you honored and glorified. And we just ask all these things in Jesus' name. And all God's people said, amen. So Nehemiah's name in the Hebrew language literally means Jehovah has consoled. And as you think about this prayer that he just prayed, how fitting is that that his name actually means someone who God has consoled? He heard the words about the great city of Jerusalem, how the people were in distress, and it was a reproach to all of those around them. And he prayed a prayer, and in that prayer, he mourned for many days. He fasted, and he prayed before the God of heaven. So just like Nehemiah, Jesus also wept over Jerusalem. We see two separate times in the life of Jesus Christ where the writers of the gospel actually recorded that our Lord was weeping. The first time was at the tomb of his friend Lazarus, John 11, verse 35. If you're a Bible driller, if you know anything about the Bible, you probably have this verse memorized. It's only two words, Jesus wept. He was saddened over the situation. He was sad that he was fixing to have to raise Lazarus up from the dead. But the next time we see Jesus weeping was in Luke. Luke chapter 19, verse 41, in his triumphal entry, as Jesus approached the city of Jerusalem, he wept over what was going on. As he approached the city of Jerusalem, he wept over it because he knew of the coming destruction that once again faced Jerusalem. So there's one similarity that we see between Jesus and Nehemiah, that they had an extreme burden over the broken state of those around them. They were compassionate to a degree that caused them to take action as well. Not only were they saddened, but they were motivated as well. Jesus said this. Jesus had one goal in mind. He said, "The Son of Man has come to seek and save that which was lost." In other words, I want to build up what the enemy has broken down. Nehemiah had one goal as well. Build the wall. Make Jerusalem great again. My city needs to be restored. So here's the question on the floor today for you. When is the last time that the condition of our nation has literally brought you to tears? There's a lot of emotions that take place when you watch the news, when you hear the reports of what's going on and the condition our nation is in. And like me, a lot of things that you see just make your blood boil. But when you really think about the spiritual condition of what's going on in our nation, does it bring you to tears? Is that something that really motivates you to pray for our nation? And in just a few moments, we're going to have a very, very special altar call to pray over our nation and to pray over this election that's going to take place on Tuesday. Next thing we see is that in a time of distress, Nehemiah brought inspiration to his teams. Not only was he a man of compassion, but he was a man of tears and a man of action as well. You see, that's what compassion is. Compassion is when you feel sorry or saddened over something, but that compassion drives you to take action over the situation. Go to chapter 2 of Nehemiah. Let's look at verses 17 through 20. Here are the actual words that Nehemiah brought to his team as they began to set forth on the work that the Lord had called him to do. What Nehemiah did is at nighttime, he rode a donkey. He sat upon the existing walls, whatever was left. He went all the way around the city, kind of measuring up and getting a game plan together, seeing what needed to be done and how they needed to start. So his game plan was to break down each section of the city wall. Each gate was designated to those who live close by it. He started assembling his teams, and here's the words that he said in verse 17. Then I said to them, you see the distress that we are in, how Jerusalem lies in waste, and its gates are burned with fire. Come and let us build the wall of Jerusalem, that we may no longer be a reproach. And I told them, here's the key right here, of the hand of my God, which had been good upon me, and also of the king's words that he had spoken to me. And listen to the response of the people when they heard these words of Nehemiah. So they said, let us rise up and build. Then they set their hands to do this good work. And look over at chapter 4, verse 6. Here's what made their effort so successful. So we built the wall. The entire wall was joined together up to half its height, for the people had a mind to work. Do we have a mind right now to see restoration in our country? Do we have a common thought as Christians and as a church that there is something we can do? As I begin thinking about this upcoming election, I begin thinking about the power of one person. Does my vote really matter? 8.1 million people in this world population, 357 million in the United States of America. Does my one vote really matter amongst all of those people who are able to vote? Now, I know you get into the Electoral College and how all this works state by state. They have so many votes that goes into this process. It's a really complicated system that they have. And when you think about that, is it really going to make a difference if I vote or if I don't vote? Yes, it does. I believe that when you prayerfully consider your candidate, your one vote does matter. And so if you think about my vote doesn't matter, I'm going to stay at home, what if all Christians had that thought? I've heard anywhere from 13 to 14 million Christians will not participate in this upcoming election. But one person can make a huge difference in what's going on in this whole process. What if Nehemiah had said, you know what, the Lord has burdened my heart, but I'm not going to respond. I don't think my effort can really make a difference. I know how big that wall around Jerusalem is. I know what it's going to take to rebuild it. I don't think I want to be a part of this process. If that was the attitude of Christians, we wouldn't stand a chance. Your one vote does make a difference. Whenever we are going in one direction and the rest of the world is going in an opposite direction, it's noticeable. People take notice when you live your life in such a way that it pleases the Lord. It's what we call countercultural. And I think that one person can most definitely make a difference. Nehemiah knew that the project was far too big and complicated for just one person. So he recruited help and kept them motivated throughout the entire process. Here's the thing. Here's where Jesus and Nehemiah are similar as well. Jesus knew that his kingdom building project would go far beyond his lifetime. He took a team of unlikely characters, rough and rugged fishermen, and he turned their world upside down in that day. And his restoration process is still going on, because those 12 went out and they prepared more. And those went out and prepared more, and the word of the gospel continued to spread. And so right now in our nation's time of distress, this is our team right here. If I can inspire you to go out and live for the Lord, if I can inspire you to go out and cast your ballot, if I can inspire you to go out and do great things for the Lord, guess what? You're going to go out and you're going to inspire someone else. They'll inspire someone else, and God's kingdom building process will continue to go forward. And just like Jesus, Nehemiah made certain that groups had specific assignments and assured them that the hand of God was upon them. Jesus said, I'm going to leave you, but I'm not going to leave you alone. I'm going to place my Holy Spirit within you. And when that happens, you're going to be able to do greater things while you do your ministry here on this earth. So right now, God has placed His Holy Spirit in you. If you're a born again, blood-bought believer, you're not alone. You have a power in you that this world doesn't understand and will never comprehend. And you have a power to do much greater things than you ever imagined. Nehemiah was a leader. Jesus was a leader. Nehemiah assembled his teams and he kept them inspired. One of the qualities and characteristics of great leadership is being able to move your people to a place where they have been, to a place where they need to go. And you need to be able to convince them that there's a higher calling for their life as well. Here's the thing. Nehemiah was a great leader because he helped keep the eyes of his team on the task at hand and not on the challenges around them. As my pastor, one of my challenges is to keep your eyes off of the past and look at what God's doing in the future. Don't look at where we've been. Don't look at what we've accomplished in the past. But you look further down the road. Why has God put us all together to accomplish a work like we've never seen before? Because there's a work to do here in this community. And my job as your pastor is to keep you moving into the future and keep your eyes off the past. John Maxwell wrote a book called The Leader's Greatest Return. And in it, he had a quote by a guy by the name of Mark Sanborn. And it says this. It says, great leaders help people have a larger vision of themselves. So here's my question at this point. Who are you inspiring today to do great things for the Lord? You know a lot more people than I know. You know some people that I'll never meet. Now what your job today is to take what you've learned this morning, what you've learned in Sunday school, and go out and impact someone else's life around you with that. And what Nehemiah did is he took the calling of the Lord, that prayer that he made, and had a goal to go out and inspire other people. Hey, we can do this. We had an enemy that's working against us, and that was something he had to deal with during the entire rebuilding process. But in his time of distress, he brought great inspiration to the teams that he was working with. One other thing that they had to deal with, throughout the entire building process, the people were faced with many different trials. Here's the thing. They didn't have modern equipment. They didn't have backhoes. They didn't have bulldozers. They didn't have concrete mixers. Their two hands and some rough, crude tools was all that they had to work with. That was the number one trial. The next trial that they had to deal with was internal conflict. There were people in their own country that was dealing with them and battling against them each and every day. Just like Nehemiah, Jesus faced internal conflict as well. There was one traitor that was among his group of 12 the whole time. His name was Judas Iscariot. Jesus also had to deal with those that should have been pulling for Jerusalem. It was called the scribes, the Sadducees, and the Pharisees. They were the religious folks. And they were battling against Jesus the entire time during his ministry. But let's look at what Nehemiah had to face with. We were in verse 18 just a moment ago. Look at verse 19. Here's the two enemies that Nehemiah had to deal with. But when Sanballat the Horonite, Tobiah the Ammonite official, and Geshem the Arab heard of it, they laughed at us and despised us and said, what is this thing that you are doing? Will you rebel against the king? Uh-oh, we got some conspiracy theorists here. We see what you're doing, Nehemiah. There's got to be a reason why you're doing it. Why are you wanting to make Jerusalem great again? You're wanting to rebel against the king, aren't you? We're going to start rumors about you. We're going to start gossip about you. And we're going to fight against you tooth and nail the entire time. Can I just say this about the nation that we live in? Our greatest enemy doesn't exist on foreign soil. Our greatest enemy exists right here on domestic land. Our enemy is internal, and we have people that are in our government elected official seats that are working against us each and every day. And here's the thing about a church. Here's the thing about any ministry you embark on. Any great work of God has always and will always be met with much resistance. That's because Satan knows how to undermine God's work, and he's going to do everything he can to try to prevent it from happening. But here's what Jesus said. Jesus said, the gates of hell will not prevail against us. And that's a promise that comes from our Lord. If you think restoration is going to come easy, you just need to think again. It took us only a few days to tear out sheetrock and pull up flooring in my house, but it has taken weeks and weeks and weeks to put it all back together the way that it should be. Tearing down is easy. Anybody can do that. Restoration, that's a whole different story. You're going to experience trials along the way, each and every step of the way, no matter what your project is. Look again in chapter 4, verse 1. But it so happened when Sambalat heard that we were rebuilding the walls that he was furious and very indignant and mocked the Jews. He spoke before his brethren in the army of Samaria and said, what are these feeble Jews doing? Will they fortify themselves? Will they offer sacrifices? Will they complete it in a day? Will they revive the stones from the heaps of rubbish, stones that are burned? And look over at verse 15 and 18 of the same chapter. Here's Nehemiah's recorded words. And it happened when our enemies heard that it had been known to us that God had brought their plot to nothing, that all of us returned to the wall, everyone to his work. So it was from that time on that half of my servants worked at construction while the other half held spears, the shields, the bows, and wore armor. So not only are they having to work to rebuild the wall, they're also having to work to defend themselves while they rebuild the wall. So Nehemiah's manpower has basically been cut in half, some to protect from the enemy and some to continue the work to provide a defense for the city from the enemy. Those who built the wall and those who carry burdens load themselves so that one hand they worked at construction and with the other hand they built a weapon. So even the ones working, they were ready to defend the city from the enemy that was wanting to attack them the whole time. Those are the trials that they faced throughout the entire rebuilding process. So they had circumstances that they had to deal with each and every step of the way. Rebuilding our country back to where it needs to be is not going to be an easy process. We have weapons of warfare. Our weapons are hand-to-hand combat. Our weapons are spiritual weapons. And our weapons are to be used throughout the entire building process. It's going to take some effort. It's going to take some work. It's going to take some commitment. It's going to take some people that can inspire others to do great things. But it's going to take each and every one of us being obedient to what the Lord has called us to do. They continued to build the wall no matter what circumstances came their way. Have you ever asked someone how they're doing and their response was, oh, I'm okay considering the circumstances. Just like in our story of Ruth last week, they had circumstances as well. If you live under your circumstances, you're never going to make it. But if you get above your circumstances, that's exactly where God wants you to be, and that's how you'll succeed in your restoration process. Point number four, the restoration process was constantly undermined by traitors. We've already seen the names of them. Chapter 6, verses 1 through 9, describes this conspiracy that was coming up against Nehemiah. Now it happened when Sambalat, Tobiah, and Geshem, the Arab, and the rest of our enemies heard that I had rebuilt the wall and that there were no breaks left in it, though at that time I had not hung the doors and the gates, that Sambalat and Geshem sent to me, saying, come, let us meet together among the villages in the plain of Ono. But they thought to do me harm. So I sent messengers to them, saying, I am doing a great work so that I cannot come down. Why should the work cease while I leave it and go down to you? Just like Nehemiah, Jesus also faced opposition to his work as well. Nehemiah's resistance came externally, basically, but Jesus' resistance came internally through the scribes, the Sadducees, and the Pharisees. Let me just say this once again. Right now, America's greatest threat comes internally. There's been many, many times throughout Israel and their lifespan and their defense of their country that their enemies knew that there was no way that they could take them externally. They said, what we need to do is we need to destroy them from the inside out. They're too strong for us to attack from the outside. What we need to do is we need to do something that will destroy them from the inside out. And so as you pray for our country, as you begin praying for this restoration process to take place, as you begin praying for a regeneration, a renewal, maybe a resurgence of Christianity and God-fearing believers throughout our country, pray that God will expose all of those who are trying to undermine what's going on in our country. As you pray for our country, pray that the true enemies of our nation would be exposed. Nehemiah called their bluff. He knew what they were after. The Lord gave him enough wisdom to see that this was a plot that's working against me. And he said, you know what? I'm just not going to be a part of it. Last point I want to make on this is that with the help of the Lord, the city was restored at just the right time. I'm sure that when Nebuchadnezzar came up against Jerusalem and the walls began tearing it down, it only took a matter of days, maybe a week or so. I don't know exactly how long. He ransacked the temple. He took all the valuable items out of it, destroyed the temple, burned it down, and then took the wall and completely broke down all the defenses that Jerusalem had built. And with the help of the Lord, the city was restored at just the right time. Go to chapter 6, verses 15. And we'll see exactly how long it took for them to rebuild the wall with the Lord's help. And just remember that they did this without any modern equipment. So the wall was finished on the 25th day of Elul in 52 days. And it happened when all our enemies heard of it and all the nations around us saw these things that they were very disheartened in their own eyes. For they perceived that this work was done by our God. And so what happens when people petition the Lord and work together for a common cause? Remember how this story started. The first step of Nehemiah was to do what? He wept, he fasted, and he prayed to the Lord. The eyes of the Lord are over the righteous, and his ears are attentive to their prayers. And we see several times throughout Scripture where people have called upon the Lord, and at just the right time, the Lord showed up. Exodus chapter 2, verses 23 through 25. We see that the Hebrew children are in slavery in Egypt, and they cry out for a deliverer. Now, it happened in the process of time that the king of Egypt died. Then the children of Israel groaned because of their bondage, and they cried out, and their cry came up to God because of their bondage. Listen at this. So God heard their groaning, and God remembered his covenant with Abraham, with Isaac, and with Jacob. And God looked upon the children of Israel, and God acknowledged them. And then Moses was born, and it took several years before their deliverance actually took place. Does God hear your prayers? Absolutely, he does. Does he respond right away? No. It's only in his timing that he responds. What we have a hard time remembering is that we are a finite man dealing with an infinite God. We are dealing with the here and now, and God is dealing with the eternal. So sometimes we get a little bit impatient with what the Lord is wanting to do in his response to our prayers. But with the help of the Lord, the city was restored at just the right time. And I believe with the help of the Lord, our nation too could be restored at just the right time. Write down this verse. It should be familiar to you. 2 Chronicles chapter 7, verses 14 through 15. This is actually taking place when Solomon dedicated the temple that he had built. He says, if my people who are called by my name will humble themselves and pray, seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then I will hear from heaven. I will forgive their sins and I will hear their land. Verse 15 is the key. Now my eyes will be open and my ears attentive to prayers made in this place. That's why this upcoming altar call is so, so important. Prayers made in this place, us praying together for one common goal. Here's the deal. If we really want to see change in our country, it doesn't begin on Capitol Hill. If we want to see change happening in our country, it doesn't begin in the White House. It begins right here in God's house. Here's the bad news. Judgment upon this land is not going to take place in Capitol Hill or the White House either. Judgment about what's happened in our country is going to begin right here as well. 1 Peter chapter 4, verse 17, it says, for the time has come for judgment to begin at the house of God. And if it begins with us first, what will be the end of those who do not obey the gospel of God? Go back to Psalm 34, verses 15 and 16 again. The eyes of the Lord are on his righteous, and his ears are open to their cry. The face of the Lord is against those who do evil, to cut off their remembrance of them from the earth. So what really does happen when a group of people genuinely commit to praying over certain issues? What happens when people set their minds to seeking the Lord's will together and commit to working together towards a common goal? The temple in Jerusalem destroyed. The walls broken down in just a matter of days. You would have thought it would take many, many years to rebuild all that. Ezra came back, started rebuilding the temple, dedicated it, and restored temple worship in Jerusalem. And then Nehemiah comes back, assembles his team, and in 52 days, Jerusalem is once again protected. What is it going to take for our nation to experience restoration? I'm certain it didn't take Nebuchadnezzar long to destroy the city of Jerusalem. Like I said earlier, our country wasn't built overnight. It took many centuries for it to be what it is today. And it seems like an impossible task to turn the tide in the direction that it needs to go in. Like I said, it doesn't take long to tear something down, but it takes great effort and intentionality to restore something. How did Nehemiah's journey begin? Prayer. One of the ways Nehemiah's life creates a picture of the Lord Jesus Christ is that it was characterized by prayer and dependence on God. Nehemiah had direct access to King Artaxerxes, who gave him the power and the authority to go back and rebuild the walls. Jesus Christ had direct communication with the Father on a daily basis. He and the Father were one. And the Father gave him authority to go and do the things that he did while he was here on this earth. How long has it taken for America to reach the state she's in now? It didn't happen overnight. Is it possible for her to return once again to be known as one nation under God? I think it all depends on what happens in God's house. I think it all depends upon what happens today. I think it all depends on what happens on Tuesday. Here's the verse that I want to lead you out on. This next slide, Ephesians chapter 3, verse 20. Now to him who is able to do exceedingly abundantly above all that we ask or think, according to the power that works in us, to him be glory, the church by Jesus Christ to all generations forever and ever. Amen. Say, Brother Tracy, how do I pray for our country? Is there something that I can model my prayer after? Where do I even start at? Go back to Nehemiah chapter 1. Let's read this prayer together. And I said, I pray, Lord God of heaven, O great and awesome God, you who keep your covenant mercy with those who love you and observe your commandments, please let your ear be attentive and your eyes open, that you may hear the prayer of your servant, which I pray before you now, day and night. For the children of Israel, your servants, and confess the sins of the children of Israel, which we have sinned against you. Both my father's house and I have sinned. If my people who are called upon by my name will humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, that's exactly what Nehemiah is doing here. We have acted very corruptly against you and have not kept the commandments, the statutes, or the ordinances which you commanded your servant Moses. Kind of sounds like America, don't it? Remember, I pray, the word that you commanded your servant Moses, saying, if you are unfaithful, I will scatter you among the nations. But if you return to me and keep my commandments and do them, though some of you were cast out in the farthest part of the heavens, yet will gather them from there and bring them to the place which I have chosen as a dwelling for my name. Now these are your servants and your people whom you have redeemed by your great power and by your strong hand. O Lord, I pray, please let your ear be attentive to the prayer of your servant and to the prayer of your servants who desire to fear your name, and let your servant prosper this day. I pray and grant him mercy in the sight of this man. Being a good citizen in the United States of America, I believe it all boils down to this. Do you love the Lord? Do you love your country? And are you burdened for your country? Are you burdened to the point to where you are willing to do something about it? If you see a problem, don't complain about it unless you're willing to do something about it. If you see something going on that's not right and you're not willing to intervene in some way, shape, or form, don't complain about it. Being compassionate means that you are stirred with emotion to a point to where you are willing to take action and do something about the situation that is saddening you. Warren Wiersbe had this to say about being a citizen. He said, the fact that we have our citizenship in heaven ought to make us better citizens on earth, no matter under what form of government we may live. And my hope and my prayer is this, that today you would be moved to do something about our nation. And my prayer is that it doesn't stop on Tuesday, that no matter who is elected as our next president of the United States, that you would continue doing something about the current state of affairs in the United States of America. Every head bowed and every eye closed. From this moment on, the altars are open. Before we sing, I'm challenging you to make a difference in our country right now. In just a moment, I'm going to let Nancy begin playing on the piano. But right now, I'm challenging you to come to these altars and pray over our country. In this moment of silence, as I pray, the time for you to move is now, if the Lord is stirring you to do so. And we're going to play just a couple of verses of the Invitational. No singing, nothing but music. But I just want everybody here to have this opportunity to come pray for our nation.